name is Matthew Guzdal. I hail from Germany, Tech, from a PhD candidate. And so we present this short work on interaction framework for studying co-creative AI. In some ways, this is going on. You can see it right there. I did it in landscape mode because I misunderstood. I can go ahead? Okay, thanks. All right, so here's the sort of framework we did, sort of inspired by LuBart, of like how you sort of structure human and AI interaction, but we wanted to do it in a sort of more systemic, sort of more detailed way, which doesn't lose any of the generality of sort of ways of representing this sort of turn-based interaction between a human and AI agent. And then in the paper, we go over, this is gonna be long because got messed up because of animations. In the paper, we go over a sort of case study with our Kai paper, which is this video game level co-creation thing with this deep reinforcement learning kind of backend. And so I'm happy to talk more to you about combined bus for just a minute. Thanks.
Hello, my name is Oana Balana. I'm from the University Polytechnic of Bucharest, Romania. In the paper, we discussed the importance of the human-centered approach for medical machine learning-based systems, in particular for virtual reality system, which treats phobia. We determine the fear levels and the game levels to be played next using machine learning and deep learning approaches. And we switched from automatic emotion recognition systems to immersive emotion recognition systems, which are based on interactive machine learning. And the stages we are identified were the gameplay and biophysical data recording, biophysical data processing, and machine learning-based fear level estimation and scenario selection, which are all based and supervised, monitored by the therapist and the human expert. My poster is the first one from there.
Hi, I'm Eliza Candelo from IBM Research, and I'm going to show a work in the context of a science museum. So we did an experiment with 30 museum guides, and we asked them how they would teach a bot to be a companion bot in the future, and how they would validate that the bot understood and learned what they teach. We found five teaching paradigms that represent the mental models of those guides. And we have some insights on new algorithms for machine teaching. And we hope to talk to you more about that.
Hi, I'm Raimund Axelt from the Interactive Media in Dresden, and I would like to introduce a visualization tool for large decision tree ensembles, such as gradient boosted trees. They are very good for predicting things like costs or revenue in the business world, but they lack interpretability and explicability. So we introduce, especially for laymen, a tool, and to make it easier, we change the large forest to a comprehensible set of rules, and they are shown on the left. And the view on the right, we have a feature view which is interactive and allows to explore such models, substitute models. Well, this is a method for especially laymen and business people, and the efficient rule extraction method allows us to visualize these decision tree ensembles in a very intuitive way. So please come to see our poster.
Hello, I'm Martin. I'm a PhD student and also employed by Sectra, where I design AI-based systems for medical imaging. In my poster over there, I show a timeline of how data can be used to structure design activities and goals. So if you want to design from a human perspective and not technology, you need to keep the tech fluid and focus on the context of use. That means I cannot only design interactions for some given data trained with a given model trained with a given data. In order to do feasible designs, this is really challenging because I need to know something about how they all relate. In my poster, I take the theory between data and model performance and show that how this has informed me in the past. I try to exemplify one way how to use it over there, but I think my time is up.
Hello, my name is Espen. I'm
one of the machine learning systems that we most commonly use in our daily lives is our search engine. The search engine, the core functionality of that is to rank our search results based on our current information needs. Current search systems don't support long-term search and like exploratory search, where you are researching something over time. So we are introducing a tool that allows people to annotate their search results and update their rankings based on that. And that is opposed to traditional information retrieval feedback mechanisms that are often implicit and based on behavioral data, where users don't have any explicit control. So this is trying to support exploratory users and give them more explicit control of their search results and long-term search. That's the summary.
Hi, my name is Janine Koch. I'm from Aalto University, and I want to talk today about ideas. Ideation is a process that we all do, and it's in the beginning of any kind of new innovation. When you, for example, look for new research topics, what you want to do, how often they're quite done in groups and very thorough ideas, and develop them further. And so, while this is very important, there's not a lot of research done yet in like how can we actually build this interactive, collaborative way on actually creating idea and finding inspiration. So in my work, I'm focusing on how to actually do that in the context of the design process and connecting visual ideation together with designers. And we built a tool, and I'm presenting a cooperative contextual vendor tool here that actually does that together with designers, which we studied, and there's more on the poster.
Hi, I'm Tom from the Freedom University of Berlin. My colleagues are Christoph Kinderle and Jesse Benjamin. We want to ask you, have you ever heard about ORS? It's a machine learning cloud web service for Wikimedia projects, notably automated quality control for Wikipedia. And depending on the context, it can be quite challenging to set a threshold for what ORS considers damaging in terms of contributions to Wikipedia. We present Precall, the ORS human-centered model selection interface for threshold optimization, and we support users in determining thresholds that fit their personal needs. In the upper part, you can see typical quality metrics, and in the lower part, you can see the expected classification results. This offers different approaches to threshold optimization. Come check out our poster to find out more about our user study.
Hi, I'm Michael Swyszynski. I'm at Goldsmiths University of London, and I make musical instruments. Typically, these instruments are made with some complex bunch of sensors on one end and a complex parameterized audio or audiovisual interaction on the other end, and so we use machine learning in the middle. So this is this typical interactive machine learning workflow with a human in the middle, but we're dealing with users who aren't particularly expert in machine learning, and perhaps not also expert in, we're using biosensors, electromyography, so not expert in how their muscles actually work. So we have a bunch of different feedback channels that we're trying to provide users information about how their input is working, how the output of the model is working. That might be the primary output which is the sound, or it might be some secondary visual output. And it gets us to this interesting point where a model is trained, a model is run, and maybe it's bad, that's one thing, maybe it's good, or maybe it's doing something we weren't expecting at all, but suggests a whole other way to work, and the next training session is a totally new goal. So this is concept evolution, co-adaptation, which is really cool. I like working with music like this, but it gives us, as experimenters, a big challenge of how do we evaluate the quality of a model if the goals keep changing? How do we know if we've given users the best setup if the goals keep changing? You know, as the machine and the human being learn together, you know, how do we know we're doing the right thing? So on one hand, it's a really exciting field, but on the other hand, it's very difficult to design experiments that really yield quantitative results that that we can take to a conference.
Hi, hello, my name is George, I'm from NYU, and today I'm going to present our poster, Why Should We Teach Machines to Read Charts Before Humans? So lately, there has been a lot of interest in teaching machine learning models to read, understand, and parse data visualizations. So we want to investigate what are the applications for HCI for that. So basically, the works can be grouped in three major categories: visual question answering, importance estimation, and data retrieval. And all those works have in common that they teach machine learning models how to understand data visualizations. So based on all those three things, these models are going to get better and better, and eventually they're going to reach human performance. So what are the implications for HCI? So we found four major applications for HCI: reproducibility of works, evaluation, so machine learning models can help us to evaluate visualizations or designs, prototyping, so they can help us prototype new visualizations, and guidance, so they can help users to read charts. So come to your poster to learn more.
Okay. Hi, I'm Agnieszka Blewicz, and I'm an interaction designer who experiments with ML as a design material, which means I build things and put them in front of people, focusing on how can we design for more democratic experience, more playful experiences, and more engaging experiences with ML, focusing on amateur end users. And today I'm here to talk about the problem of explainability and interpretability, and how could we focus more on implicit learning, which is the kind of learning that occurs without conscious efforts from our side when we see complex structures that maybe are beyond our cognitive abilities. And if you want to see kind of experiments that I do both with open-ended interactive machine learning and also design patterns that can be put into devices that already exist, you can see this horizontal yellow poster that is very unevenly hanged out.
Hi, my name is Rayhong, and I came from New York University. So today, I will just like briefly discuss about the projects that we are just working on in NYU. It's about how to just like make the machine learning as a more kind of general problem-solving toolkit for people who doesn't know about the machine learning, basically. So I think that the background is that user base of the machine learning is expanding. It's not very surprising. There are many papers that discuss about, like, you know, talking about how just like novice machine learning users start to build their models and then just apply their things and then what is the difficulties in there. And then now the knowledge gap is very different. Like before, it was really just like professional kind of questions that people just ask, but now it's like even they don't know about like sometimes like the target variables or what is the independent variables and the dependent variables and so forth. So I guess this is the three main research directions that we are doing. I think that we are mostly interested in the first of all, the empirical approach that, like, whether the interpretability in machine learning and then, like, all of the stuff that we are discussing is actually happening in the real world, like, for the data scientists and then maybe UX researchers who are using machine learning to just apply the kind of problem solving situation. Okay. So I think there are two more, but just please come by and just talk about it. Thank you.